Test, test. Lectern test. Test, test. Test, test, test. Good morning, I'm Reverend Joanna. Welcome home. Unitarian Universalism is unambiguously, unapologetically progressive. This church affirms the inherent worth and dignity of all people through our work with anti-racism, anti-oppression, supporting the LGBTQIA+ community, working for reproductive justice, voting rights, and other issues as needed. We seek to build beloved community not only here, but also in our surrounding area and across all of Texas. And we bring a spirit of joy to it all. It is so good to be together this morning. Would you please rise either in body or in spirit for our opening hymn, Morning Has Come.
Welcome to Live Oak Unitarian Universalist Church. My name is Margie Taylor, and one thing I love about Live Oak is our services. We have Chris and Daria leading us in music, and we have Chris taking us through Time of Wonder, and then Reverend Joanna takes us through wonderful, inspiring, and informative sermons. I'd like to welcome any guests we have today. If this is your first time here, please stop by the visitors table so we can meet you and answer any questions you might have. As part of our mission, we want to enhance the connections between each of us and also with the outside world. You can stay connected with everything happening at Live Oak through our weekly email newsletter. There's a link on our homepage. And during this worship service, no need to put your phone away. We encourage you to post on social media things you hear today, maybe even an invitation for a friend to join you next week. Now we will have the chalice lighting. Today our chalice at Live Oak is being lit by August Huff. And now, here and at home, let us light our chalices with these words. Even though you're not equipped, keep searching. Equipment isn't necessary on the way to the sustainer. Whoever you see engaged in search, become her friend and cast your head in front of her. For choosing to be a neighbor of seekers, you become one yourself. Everything you possess of skill and wealth and handicraft wasn't at first merely a thought and a quest. It's not true. Technical difficulties. Thank you, August. This is a congregation bound not by creed, but by covenant. May those in agreement affirm this covenant now. We affirm a caring community of and for all ages, seeking wisdom, doing service, and living with integrity. In our diversity, our covenant holds us in unity as we celebrate our shared spiritual journey.
A community of and for all ages, as you just saw, because it takes all of us to light that chalice and keep it lit. A special part of Unitarian Universalist Sunday services is our time of sharing joys and sorrows. I think of it as the time when we keep vigil for one another, when we give one another the gift of being present to those among us who have had some special milestone in their personal lives or some particular joy or sorrow that it is important for the congregation to know. And today, Wren Goss shares the joy. My joy is me and my mom cleaned my room. Okay. Dan Scott says, taking great joy in the new Lakeline Park miles of hike and bike trails, playscape for the kids, lake with rental kayaks and canoes. Yes. And Apollo shares, my joy is lots of people showed up to the rally in the Capitol yesterday. I cried because of seeing just how many support my community, trans. Often what is heavy on our hearts are our own fears that we have fallen short. We know that we have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. May we have the courage to be honest with ourselves, the willingness to make amends, and the compassion to accept forgiveness from others and from ourselves, trusting in the assurance that imperfection is expected, and love is the guiding and healing force with which we can align our lives.
My name is Chris German, and I serve as your Lifespan Faith Development Director, and I have a story for you. Oh, and I want to share that I use she, her pronouns. I need a helper because I have something in this hand, and I've got something in this hand, and so I need a volunteer. Do I have to say, Des, would you like to volunteer for me? Come give me a hand, Des. Thank you so much. Come on up. So I wonder what could be in our story basket today, Des. So I'm going to hand you the basket, and I'm going to ask you, are you going to go? Awesome, welcome. Maybe one of you could hold it, and one of you could pull the bag out. And then you hold the bag open and let Des reach inside. And let's see what's inside. The possibilities are endless. Oh, do we know what this is? Do you know what that is? Oh, a tiny disco ball. I love that. What do you think, Wren? Like a prism, huh? Yes, this is a prism. And the thing about a prism is, see all the different edges on it? It catches the light. And when the light shines through it, like through a window, it does something. And I'm going to share a story about what it does. So I'm going to give you this back to put it in the bag. And I'm going to tell a story, and then I'm going to invite you guys to rejoin your grown-ups. So the story I want to share with you is a personal story from my life. So have you ever remember back when you had younger kids, or you were a younger kid? And, well, let me just back up a little bit. I got up one morning, it was a weekday, and my child had a doctor's appointment. And I was like, come on, let's go. Eat breakfast. Let's go. Can you put on your shoes? Yes, I know there's sand spurs on your shoes. Yes, I know they're really cool and they have hooks on the end. That's really cool. Yes, let's keep going. Have any of you ever done that to your parents? Have you ever slowed them down when they are saying, we're in a hurry, let's go? Yeah. As a grown-up, have you ever had to wait on people when they're like, you're in a hurry, but they're not quite on your schedule? Yeah, it happens to all of us, right? So I'm really getting kind of stressed because we have a doctor's appointment. We need to get to the doctor's appointment. And my child, Morgan, just keeps stalling. And I'm like, okay, I got to go. I'm like, all right, I'm going to the car. And I'm running to the car. And I hear Morgan said, I have to go in this room. I have to go in the sunroom and I have to get something. And I hear, Mom. And it was a different kind of mom. And it stopped me. And I was like, what's going on? And so I run back in there, you know, because I'm in a hurry, right? I'm really stressed and I'm in a hurry. And I go around the corner, and in this room, I had hung a prism. And Morgan had never seen it in the morning. And the room was full of rainbows. And I stepped around the corner, and I almost stepped on one. And Morgan said, stop. Look. Mom, isn't this incredible? Morgan was 5. And I stopped and I breathed and I said, yes, it is. Wow. And in that moment, I was so filled not only with the wonder of the rainbows shining all over the room, but also by love for this individual who saw the wonder and awe in the world, who saw the sacred, who found the holy, even when being rushed. And I wonder how many things do we miss in a day, every day, because we're not paying attention or we're in a hurry. So I wonder this week, how many things can you notice and you can find that bring awe and wonder and sacredness and the holy into your life? And with this, our story is told. Thank you so much for your help. Thank you.
And now would you please rise in body or in spirit for our hymn, Holy Now.
Little warning and a heads up, when we get to the last verse, I'm going to put a pause in there because I want to emphasize those words.
When I was a boy each week, Sunday we would go to church, pay attention to the priest. He would read the holy word. And you think of holy bread, everyone would kneel. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. When I was in Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two. Made the water wine. I remember feeling sad, miracles don't happen still. Now I can't keep track. Everything's a miracle. Everything's a miracle. Wine from water is not so small, but an even better magic trick. Anything is here at all. So the challenging thing becomes not to look for miracles, finding where there's even one. When holy water was rare at best, barely wet my fingertips. Now I have to hold my breath. I'm swimming in a sea of it. Used to be a world half there, heaven second rate hand me down, but I walk it with a reverent air. Everything is holy now. Everything is holy now. Read a questioning child's face. Say it's not a testament, that would be a very hard thing to say. See another new morning come, say it's not a sacrament, and I'll tell you that it can't be done. This morning outside I stood, saw a little red-winged bird, shining like a burning bush, singing like a scripture verse. Made me want to bow my head. I remember when church let out, how things have changed since then. Everything is holy now. Used to be a world half there, heaven second rate hand me down, walking. Sing the chorus. Everything, 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 everything is holy now.
Reading from The Art of Pilgrimage by Phil Cousineau. What do we do if we feel a need for something more out of our journeys than the perennial challenges and pleasures of travel? What happens if the search for the new is no longer enough? What if our heart aches for a kind of journey that defies explanation? Centuries of travel lore suggest that when we no longer know where to turn, our real journey has just begun. At that crossroads moment, a voice calls to our pilgrim soul. The time has come to set out for the second ground, the mountain, the temple, the ancestral home, that will stir our heart and restore our sense of wonder. It is down the path to the deeply real, where time stops and we are seized by the mysteries. This is the journey we cannot not take. On that long and winding road, it is easy to lose the way. Listen. The old hermit along the side of the road whispers, "Stranger, pass by that which you do not love."
of a starving, needing when I'm full of. How about them transparent, dangling carrots? How about that ever elusive kudo? Thank you, India. Thank you, terror. Thank you, disillusionment. Thank you, frailty. Thank you, consequence. Thank you, silence. How about me not blaming you for everything? How about me enjoying the moment for once? How about how good it feels to finally forgive you? How about grieving it all one at a time? Thank you, India. Thank you, terror. Thank you, disillusionment. Thank you, frailty. Thank you, consequence. Thank you, silence. The moment I let go of it was the moment I got more I could handle. The moment I jump off of it was the moment I touched down. How about no longer being masochistic? How about remembering your divinity? How about unabashedly bawling your eyes out? How about not equating death with stopping? Thank you, India. Thank you, Providence. Thank you, disillusionment. Thank you, nothingness. Thank you, clarity. Thank you, silence.
So that song by Alanis Morissette, done so beautifully by Daria. It came out of a pilgrimage when Alanis Morissette went to India. Thank you, India. Thank you, consequence. Thank you, disillusionment. Thank you, frailty. Thank you, silence. When I completed my pilgrimage last summer, not my sabbatical that I will forever also be grateful for, but my pilgrimage, much shorter period of time, and I began the long journey home, it was that song that was playing in my head, and tears were just washing, pouring over my face. I was overwhelmed with gratitude for the epiphanies that had come to me, the lessons, and a shift, a change in who I was. What would it look like for you if you were to take not a trip, or a vacation, but a pilgrimage. Something that could change you inside so much that you would be speechless. You were so overwhelmed with thankfulness. What might that look like for you? Pilgrimage is a religious term, and it's very interesting to me. I think that there must be something simply in the nature of being human that calls out for pilgrimage, because you find it in so many different cultures and so many different religions. It's in Islam, it's a core tenet, right, to go to Mecca at some point in your lifetime. It's in Judaism, it's in Christianity from the very beginnings of the early church. It's in Hinduism, it's in Buddhism, Baha'i, Shintoism, so many of the native religions across the earth. There is something in us that calls us to make a journey where, yes, we have a destination, but the ultimate destination is something inside of us. Again, what might your pilgrimage be? We do have Unitarian Universalist pilgrimages. It is a common thing, like for youth groups or groups of adults, to go up to Boston and see all of these famous sites, maybe go see Walden, some other things like that. We also have pilgrimages to civil rights sites. Some of our members have gone on those. And there are other secular versions of pilgrimages that, you know, we hear about all the time, and maybe you have taken one. It's where there is a destination that is important to you, and you may not even know why. Or maybe you absolutely know why, like it's the Baseball Hall of Fame, but until you take that journey, you don't know that what you're searching for is actually something inside of you. Pilgrimage is a subject for so much art through the ages. It's a subject of books, of music, and of movies. Three that I particularly love and recommend: The Way, starring Martin Sheen, directed by his son Emilio Estevez; Wild, based on the true story of Cheryl Strayed's trek across the Pacific Crest Trail; and Dark Divide. You may have heard of the other two, but Dark Divide, I think, is one that is more unknown. And it is, again, a true story. The story of a lepidopterist, am I saying that right? The, you know, butterfly and moth scientist who goes into an undeveloped park doing research and comes out with changes in him, including a pretty radical change in his life. If you're looking for sort of a guidebook, I think this is the best, and we have, or will have after this sermon, a copy in our library. The Art of Pilgrimage by Phil Cousineau. You heard a reading from it, and it has become sort of a modern classic on this topic. But so what is the difference between just a trip or a vacation and a pilgrimage? Well, in that book, the Irish priest and poet John O'Donohue is quoted as saying, "A bona fide pilgrimage may mean becoming more conscious about yourself and the world, but it needs to bring about a change of mind, a shift in the soul. No change, no pilgrimage." I think that the start of any pilgrimage is first simply to decide that that's what you're going to do. I mean, I think that I'm sure that there are stories of someone not knowing that they were embarking on a pilgrimage and it becomes that. But I think that it is more helpful to be very intentional about this, to say, okay, I am going to prepare myself. I am going to open myself up for changes in me and for new ways of looking at the world. In the book, Cousineau says, "If we truly want to know the secret of soulful travel, we need to believe that there is something sacred waiting to be discovered in virtually every journey." So what is sacred to you? I mean, especially if you grew up in either a high control fundamentalist religion, like there are probably a lot of associations with the word sacred that you have rejected, that you have left behind. Or if you grew up in a more agnostic family, sacred could be kind of an unfamiliar word. Like, you know that it, you know, other people use it, but what does it mean to you? What is it that allows you to step outside of being on autopilot, to take a break from the normal anxieties and stress, the minutiae of your life, and to realize that there is something bigger and that you are a part of this earth and that you are alive? I think that if you ask yourself those questions, those are going to lead you to what you find sacred. He also says, if you truly want to know the secret of soulful travel, we need to believe that there is something sacred waiting to be discovered in virtually every journey. For me, it was, first and foremost, the natural world. Natural science. There is something about that, and let's see. Oh, she seems to have gone out on me, but you may find a video right around this sacred stuff that, there we go. So I've shared this video before. There is something about natural science, even when I understand it, that just fills me with awe. I understand the science behind adding, you know, an egg and some flour and some sugar together, and yet the fact that it can turn into a cake still completely astounds me. And so when I heard about these ringing rocks in Montana, where when they are all piled up together, when you hit them, they sound like you're ringing a bell. There was something in me that knew that this was sacred to me and wanted to go see it. And so that's really how I began creating my pilgrimage to Montana. Also, the whole idea of what we as humans do as religious expression. I mean, no surprise there, right? I have decided to spend my life in the world of religion. But whenever I get to go and see some type of an expression of how other humans have taken these things for which we have no words for, and they have found words and rituals and practices, I wanted to go see that. And so when I found out that in Montana, on a Indian reservation, that there was this thing called the Garden of 1,000 Buddhas. And then I read about how it came to pass that these Tibetans got together with the tribal leaders and they found that they had so much in common that they were allowed to create this, and they still have festivals that they all do together. Okay, that was a pilgrimage site that I wanted to see. And then the big one for me is something that is so common. And yet for me, it takes me out of just my daily existence. And it reminds me of what a miracle life on this earth is. And it's water. And so I sought out water everywhere that I could find it. I found it in little creeks. I found it in roaring falls. I found it in lakes. I walked in it. I sat beside it. This, to me, too, is sacred. Those are the things for me. What is it for you? What is it that allows you to feel more connected with all that is, and allows you to meet, really feel the fact that you are alive? It's what inspires in you a feeling of reverence, a feeling of awe, and it gives to you a path for transformation. as you're preparing for your pilgrimage, one of the things to think about is the journey itself, as Cousineau writes. I don't like the journey itself most of the time. I blame Star Trek, right? Right? Any other trekkers that are like, why can't we just go into the thing and then be there already? And especially flying. It's not that I hate flying. Actual flying itself, I'm fine with. But now the whole airport and canceled flights and summer. Anyone fly last summer? Anyone have challenges with flying last summer? Yes, so did we. Part of setting an intention that you are going on a pilgrimage means setting the idea that perhaps there is nothing wasted. Perhaps everything is important, even those challenges. In fact, most pilgrimages, when you read these stories or watch those movies, that's a central part of it, is overcoming challenges. And we had a lot of challenges on our trip to Montana, including arriving late at 1 a.m. and the cell signal for both of our phones was completely out in about 4 states. And there we are driving dark streets of Montana. But you know what? It sure made a story. And I kept running into things like this, usually about once a day. And I think that we don't have to believe that there is a meaning that some force is causing. We can choose to take meaning for ourselves and say, okay, so what am I learning about this? Well, I'm learning that I may have an obstacle, and yet I can go on and have a really good day. So we set ourselves up for the journey itself. How can you prepare yourself for every step along the way, for seeing every person who comes across your path as a potential teacher and every situation a potential lesson? What about being blessed? Cousineau talks about how historically you would always go and you would ask for a blessing before you began your journey, because a lot of times the journey was very dangerous. I took that to heart, and I asked a religious mentor of mine for a blessing. And first, what happened is we talked a little bit about what I wanted to have, what I was hoping for on my pilgrimage. And then he prayed over me, and it made me feel a little bit more prepared for what I was about to do. It helped me be really clear of, this is my intention, to open myself up to mysteries. Who might you ask to bless you as you go on your pilgrimage? I volunteer. You definitely can ask your minister, but there may be someone very close to you that you want to talk to about this, that you can be vulnerable with, about the shifts that you are hoping to see in yourself. Those divinities who have blessed us with a journey await our offerings at every sacred destination. This is also a part of thousands of years of history of people bringing offerings when they go on pilgrimage. Indeed, at that at the Garden of 1,000 Buddhas, next to, and they literally have, it's like literally 1,000 Buddhas, all of these different things. It's not metaphorical. And so people would leave coins at those as a way of putting into form their gratitude. Maybe for you, it is picking a rock up at one end of the trail, because of course, for hikers, we take very seriously, you know, don't take out anything, don't bring anything. If it's a little rock and you get it at the start of the trail and then you return it at the end in gratitude for the trip itself, I think there's value in that. And it doesn't have to be anything physical. It can be a prayer, it can be a poem, it can be a meditation. What is the offering that you want to take on your pilgrimage. The journey reminded you of the sacred rhythms. How will you remember to remember when you return home? I think that we have to kind of hold this intention. I imagine some of us have seen, or maybe we have even been, that person who is not even looking at the Grand Canyon, right? Because they're so busy taking video and pictures. What is this? Like that's not how we do it anymore. Anyway, I'm old, y'all. How will you record what you saw? How will you remember it? This is something I really like. Don't skip this step to think about this beforehand. Because on the other end of the spectrum are the people who say, I am simply going to experience it. And there is a lot of value in that. But no matter how good our memories are, I don't think our brains can hold all of the things that we want to remember. It's kind of like when we wake up after a really intense dream, and you know right when you wake up that you're going to remember everything about it, right? Because it was so intense. And 5 minutes later, right, it's gone. What? How do I get back to it? It was so important. How are you going to record it? Maybe some of it will be pictures, maybe it will be drawings. I'm a big fan of journaling or writing letters to someone at the end of every day. But how will you remember it? Pilgrimage is often regarded as the universal quest for the self. Though the form of the path changes from culture to culture, through different epochs of history, one element remains the same: renewal of the soul. So one thing I don't have on a slide here, but that I think is so important, is to leave ourselves open for surprise. To really, like, how do you prepare for that? I don't know, other than to say, I'm going to leave some space, I'm going to leave some margin, I'm going to lift up a hope that I will in some way be surprised by something that I discover on this journey. That third movie that I was pointing out, the one about the lepidopterist, he was a skeptic. He was a professor. He was a scientist. He took that trip. He is still the expert on moths and butterflies and all that. He's also an expert, because of his experiences, on Sasquatch. Didn't see that one coming. Neither did he. And he met with some of the native people and he learned the legends. He had experiences that he could not explain away. So what might be your surprises? For me, I am very lucky. I got to take two pilgrimages. One, the one to Montana, was very much, I think, kind of what you would think of as a pilgrimage, right? I mean, going to Garden of 1,000 Buddhas, seeing nature, having a designated thing that I was doing. And I did get a lot from it, and there were shifts inside me. But when I had those tears rolling down my face, it was after a trip where I drove by myself over to Tennessee to stay in the lake house of a friend's mom, get some writing done. The first surprise was that when I arrived at the cabin late at night, pitch dark, went in there, there were lights, but there was no Wi-Fi. Not only was there no Wi-Fi, there was no cell service. Out in the dark, in a cabin, in a place I'm unfamiliar with, out in the boonies, and no way to be connected to any other human. I'm really embarrassed to admit this, but that night I was like, oh no, 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 no. Yes, sounds like a horror movie. I probably would have gotten back in my truck and driven out to find like a hotel that was more like what I wanted to have happen, except that I had no cell signal and I didn't know this place, so I didn't even have GPS. I was to discover the next day that if I walked all the way down to the lake and if the clouds happened to part, I got just enough signal that I could text my spouse and let him know I'm not dead. Occasionally text my friend and say, hey, can we meet up for lunch or for me to share all of these things, all of these thoughts that I'm having? And I had so many thoughts because I was on an unintentional silent retreat in every aspect. If you want to know what this is like, for those of you who don't think that you're that attached to your phone, right? Just take your phone out and put it somewhere else for 1 hour and just go and sit outside for 1 hour. And even then, like, you're still, it's your house, right? It opened up for me myself. And I was flooded with thoughts and ideas and epiphanies. I did do some writing, but a lot of it was based on this. And a shift happened in me, multiple shifts. And so when I got back into my truck to begin the long journey home, it was those words by Alanis Morissette that were playing in my head because I was so overwhelmed with getting reacquainted with myself. Alanis Morissette said of her pilgrimage, basically, I had never stopped in my whole life, hadn't taken a long breath. When I did stop and I was silent and I breathed, I was just left with an immense amount of gratitude and inspiration and love and bliss, and that's where the song came from. And so for me, laughing at myself as I did so, driving my pickup back to Texas, I was singing, "Thank you, Tennessee. Thank you, Providence. Thank you, disillusionment. Thank you, nothingness. Thank you, clarity. Thank you, silence." What might your pilgrimage look like? I invite you now to join me in a time of reflection and meditation in word and in silence. This is Finisterre by David White. The road in the end, taking the path the sun had taken into the western sea, and the moon rising behind you as you stood where ground turned to ocean, no way to your future now but the way your shadow could take, walking before you across water, going where shadows go, no way to make sense of a world that wouldn't let you pass except to call an end to the way you had come, to take out each frayed letter you had brought and light their illumined corners and to read them as they drifted on the western light, to empty your bags, to sort this and to leave that, to promise what you needed to promise all along and to abandon the shoes that had brought you here right at the water's edge, not because you had given up, but because now you would find a different way to tread. And because through it all, part of you would still walk on, no matter how, over the waves. And let's hold that for a moment together in sacred stillness. Amen, and blessed be.
We are the tradition of the Free Church. Our church and our community outreach are supported not from an outside source, but from within. Generosity, therefore, is one of the spiritual values we recognize as central to our personal and our institutional well-being. We share what is offered every week with an organization that upholds our Unitarian Universalist values. This month, we are helping to empower the dream of Literacy Council WILCO. It provides adults with access to quality education and job training so that they can enter sustainable careers and secure a better tomorrow. We partner with them to provide English as a second language classes, adult basic education tutoring, and Reading Academy, which are group classes to prepare people for taking the GED exam. May an offering be received with gratitude and love.
Is one of my favorite hymns. Just beautiful. This morning, Faith Development Hour, I would like to share that Seeing White is meeting in room 105. This is their last session. So I invite you to join them at promptly 11:05. Our adult OWL, parents and caregivers of sexuality educators, is happening in room 205, and of course we have OWL for our two OWL classes, and everybody knows how that works. We sign up our kids out there in the far corner of the fellowship hall. I do want to say that we've had quite a few people had to call out today for Faith Development Hour, so all the children that are not participating in OWL, we're going to use this as an opportunity to find the wonder and awe of our playground and build community together through play today. So if you would like to grab a cup of coffee and join us on the playground, more eyes and hands are always welcome. And I want to invite Carrie up to share with you about our caring circle that is happening this afternoon.
Good morning. Today at 1 o'clock in the sanctuary, we're going to be holding a community care circle for the LGBTQIA community, adults, teens, and parents. We've rallied, we've dropped cards, we've made phone calls, and what we need is the deep nourishment of each other. So we invite you, if you're part of the queer community, please come. We're going to have meditative crafts, we're going to have pastoral care, we'll have resources, and most importantly, we'll have each other to hold each other.
And now, if you would, please rise as you are willing and able for our closing hymn, Wayaya.
Heaven knows that we are going, but
In his book, Cousineau makes the point that your journey does not have to take multiple days. It could be here an hour across town, and it doesn't even have to require a trip. It could be beginning a new project that you have been dreaming of forever, finally starting that painting or building something or starting that long dreamed of novel that is in your heart. What will your pilgrimage look like? During this week, may you know extravagant joy, may you spread love, and may you hold peace in your heart until we are together again. Go in peace.
Is August around to extinguish the chalice? Okay, good. Let us say these words to each other. We extinguish this chalice flame, daring to carry forward the vision of this free faith, that freedom, reason, and justice will one day prevail in this nation and across the earth. And now as we depart, we extend and receive the gift of hospitality by taking the first 5 minutes to talk to someone whom we don't yet know well. May we all know the blessings of friendship and community.
Thank you.